colleague of mine in New York City, he was about to officiate the wedding, and just before the beginning of the ceremony, they introduced to him the two Edim, the two witnesses. So, because he's also a Dayan, he is a rabbinic court, a judge, in a very observant area in Borough Park. So, he looked at one of the witnesses, and he took him aside, and he said, "Aren't you ashamed of yourself? You remember, not long ago, several months ago, you are in the court for stealing. And we fine you and everything. So why are you even thinking about being a witness at the chasene, at the wedding?" So the guy looked at him and said, "Kvod Arav, I since that I became a Baal Tshuva." So the question is that enough to take his words, that he's now a Baal Tshuva, or not? We are now in the era of the days of Oz, the May Teshuva, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur. So we all know the Rambam, in Hilchot Teshuva, what did the Rambam said? That if yesterday a person was a horrible man, woman, and that person made the Teshuva, so all the sin turned to be good deeds. And before the Almighty is good and well, etc. Now, if that person turns to be whatever it is and it's down the next day after the Rav officiated, and allow him to be witness, and back to old business, is another court case of him doing something wrong. So the question is, what exactly the attitude toward situation like that, when it's come to a dut? A big part of our discussion today, it's the Hilchot Shomrim, the law of the safeguard, the law of people who was either have a lost item, or they have a deposit, or loans. How about minor? All these halachot, when it's come to shmira, when it's come to guarding, we're going to discuss in today daf. Today it's instructed Bava Kama, daf kuf zayin, page 107. We start with 106, 13 lines from the bottom of the page. Here we have a case. Two people come before the Bet Din. Let's call them name Mr. Cohen and Mr. Levi. So Mr. Cohen was sued by Mr. Levi. Mr. Levi said that he lent him $1,000 several months ago. Mr. Cohen said, "I never took a loan from you. So what do you do now?" Or in this case, one who falsely states a claim with regard to a lost item that a thief stole it. Meaning, Mr. Cohen was in charge for a box full of jewelry, and Mr. Levy came back from vacation and is no more Rolex that was part of that package, and Mr. Cohen said somebody stole it. So if someone found something that was lost, we have some ways to search, for example, if it's a sign there. The question is, the Torah requires us to treat it as they said in Dvarim 22, it's yours if you found something or if you're in charge of something. But the question is, how far you go with this type of shmirah? So here the problem is that he pretend that he's not, and so they said meshalem tashlumei kefel, need to pay double payment. is the story about Reb Dovid from Ual. Reb Dovid from Ual was a great Hasidic master, and his uncle was the Rebbe of Shineva. It was one of the great Hasidic master. So he said there is a pasuk, there is a sentence in Tehillim. They said, Shofech buz al nedivim, Vayat'em betohu lo darech, Vayisagev evyon me'oni, Vayasem katzon mishpachot. So those days, the Polish government forced people to come and serve in the army. So they call this fellow, Reb Dovid, to come and serve, and he went to his uncle for blessings. So he said to him, let me give you a mashal, an allegory. Imagine that you're standing at the front of the water, the ocean, and all of a sudden an expensive item, you hold, let's say, a silver spoon, fell there. You figure out you cannot do much. But then the servant of the king came there, and the same thing happened to him. And he right away makes phone calls, and somehow he gets out his spoon. By doing so, he gets out also your, just by the way. So he said, when you go there, hopefully not just you, but other people that was drafted there may be able to be out, and that's exactly what happened. Because of his zchut avot, because of his merit, not only him, but others. But anyway, they said, my tama, what's the reason? Al kol aveda, dichtiv al kol aveda, asher ya'amer. The Torah said in the book of Shmot, chapter 22, verse 8, said, for any lost item about which one shall say, this is it, the claims of both of them shall come before the judges. The one whom the judges convict shall pay double to his neighbor. So what you see, the double payment applies to a false claim of a theft, even with regard to a lost item. So the Shulchan Aruch in Choshen Mishpat 352 said, I'm reading from Koren translation of the code. If one finds a lost item and then claims that it was stolen from him and took an oath to that effect, and witnesses testified that it had been in his possession the entire time, he is considered a thief and is liable to pay double payment. If the lost item was an animal and he had slaughtered or sold it after taking a false oath, he's liable to pay arba v'chamisha, a four and five-fold payment. The Rambam, in Ilchot Gneiva, chapter 4, said that this halacha is only if he had claimed that it has been stolen from him by armed, you know, bandits and people like that, which is in a case of doers. By contracts, the tour holds, again, tour is in the Choshen Mishpan 352, that this halacha, even if he had claimed that it was a standard theft. Eitivei Rabbi Abba Bar Mamal l'Rabbi Chiya Bar Abba. The Torah portion of Shomer Chinam, of someone who is a free belly, Torah said, ki yiten ish, if a man gives his neighbor a money or vessels to safeguard. So what we said, en tinat katan klum, that if you have a minor, it's a giving of a deposit to a minor, by a minor is nothing. So what do we derive from that? Ve'en li ela shel netano kshu katan udvor shu katan. You give it to him when he's a minor, and then you lodge the claim concerning against him, against the belly, when he says still a minor. However, netano shu katan udvor shu gadol, gave it to him when he was 11 and a half years old, and now he's 14, minayin. So how do you know that even in this case, the belly is not liable? בתלמוד. לומר עד האלוהים יבוא דבר שניהם. The word אלוקים, in that sense, it apply, אלוקים ניצב בעלת כל, that's applied to the דיינים. So they said, the claims of both of them shall come before the judges. עד שתהן נתינה ותביעה שווים כאחד. The claim is valid only when the giving of the deposit and the claim are equal, both done when it's an adult. ואם איתה תה ונעמקה וידה, you may say that you treated like a lost item as well. So therefore, what do you see here? And one who receives a deposit from a minor should be liable for double payment, like Tashlumei Kefel. So here you see, Rashi tells us that we should have the same treatment in a Hava Amina for someone who ever deposits when it's a minor, and now he is an adult. So he can take an oath against that guardian. So he said, Amar Lei, Rabbi Chiya Bar Abba said, Rabbi Abba Bar Mamal, Hacha, here the examination of taking an oath when he was a minor and now he's an adult, b'may askinan, kegon she'achalo kshu katan. You have to say that what happened, that he is consumed the deposit when he was a minor. So therefore, you can treat it that way. So it means the picadon, the deposit, wasn't in his possession when he was a mature adult. So they said, aval kshu gadol mai, hachana medem shalem, יאחי עד הטענה, עד שתן נתינה ותביעה שווים כאחד, what we said until the נתינה, that he gave it לתנת שתה אכילה ותביעה שווים כאחד. So it should be that they're only when the consumption of the deposit and the claim are equal. So why the טענה need to say that even when it was a mature adult, אמר לתנת שתה אכילה ותביעה שווים כאחד, רבש שאמר לא דמי. Now we're going to see the second and the third ruling of Rabbi Chiya Bar Abba. Rav Ashi אמר לו דמי אבדה כאתיה מכוח בן דעת. והלא אתיה מכוח בן דעת. So this was for the one who was the mentally competent, but this deposit given to a minor did not come into his possession by power of one who was mentally competent. So the way that you see it from the view of Halakha, a minor is not considered mentally competent, and therefore he has no grounds for a claim. So Tosfot said here, ואליבא דרב אשי דאמר אין יכול להשביע כלל במה שיפקידו בקטנותו, אפילו הפיקדון בעין, אבל שינוי הכמה יכול להשביעו כשהוא בעין. So here you see the Tosfot, you see also the view of the שיטה מקובצת, that netina, you don't require in order for the guardian to be responsible to take an oath, but you have to have the beginning of the process. When you have tchilat biat hachefetz, beginning to have this item in his hand as a framework of a shmira. The Ravid hold, if the item came to his hand when the owner is not competent, is not mentally competent, so that he's not responsible. It's a story about the Satmar Rebbe. He came to Israel, and one of his Hasidim was a medical doctor, and he complained to the Rebbe, and he said that other doctors were called all the times during the day, and he, because he's expert or whatever it is, the always patient calling him at night, he needs to run to hospitals and homes at night. It's overwhelmingly difficult. So the Rebbe said to him, wants to encourage him. And he said, look, there are several mitzvot involved in your life. One is the mitzvah of Rapo Yirapeh. You have the mitzvah to heal people. But he said, as the Rambam said, Rambam was also a physician, he says, in addition to the mitzvah of ripui, you have a mitzvah of gmilut chasadim, of loving kindness, and you have what we said in this sugya, You have the mitzvah of Hashavat Aveda, that you, in a way, when you're giving to a person their life or his or her body, you are basically fulfill a derivative from this mitzvah of returning a lost item. So in this way, he encouraged him. The last ruling of Rabbi Chiya bar Abba in the name of Rabbi Yochanan is in regards to the Toen Ta'anat Ganav. Amar Rabbi Chiya bar Abba, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Toen Ta'anat Ganav v'Pikadon, Eno Chayav Ad Sheichpo v'Mikzat v'Yode v'Mikzat. So it said that it's only until he denies part of the claim and admits part of the claim. So, for example, the one who deposit said that he took two oxen, and the guardian said one I'm negligible, but the second one somebody stole it for me. So you see here, in part he admits, in part not. The Rosh said the whole claim is only if it's modeh b'miktzat ha'tana. Otherwise, as we said in several places, it's not effective. But Tosfot Reed and others said that the whole notion of shvuah, of oath, for sure he needs to do it. Pnei Yehoshua said that Rashi follows the Rosh, and that's the way we understand. But Rabbeinu Meir Simcha basically tried to bring the notion of Tosfot Reed. My time, Adam, Arkraki, who's it? Because the Torah said clearly this is it. So the whole idea is only in part and not more. That's what the Abba Mikzat. Upliga de Rav Chiya bar Yosef, the Amar Rav Chiya bar Yosef. Page 107, Eruv Parshiyot Katuv Kan. So you have here the notion of merging portions. So there are two school of thoughts. You have the Rashi and the Geonim that hold that all this mixture of Parshiyot, it's speaking only about loan, not to deposit. By contrast, you have the Tosfot citing Rabbeinu Tam. He said that the merging of the Torah portions, Asher Yomar Kihuze, that the halakha written by the context of deposits also extends to a loan. So therefore, the point is held here that one is obligated to take an oath with regard to a deposit only when one's claim that deposit was lost or stolen, or that he never received it. This is associated with the admission that one still owes some part of the deposit. But again, as we said, that there is a Meiri and the Rashba, because the Gemara is not differentiating between a loan and deposit. Rather, with the domain of deposit, it is a differentiation between a claim that also applicable to a loan and a claim that is not. So basically, the whole idea is that one needs to take an oath only when he admitted to a part of the claim, as we said earlier. That's applied to deposit when the claim is one that also be stated in regard to a loan, which means that the exchange never occurred, but not those claims specific to the domain of deposits, that the item was lost in the circumstances beyond the Bailey control. So the idea here, the Tosfot citing Riva, he said if a Bailey states a claim with regard to a deposit that could be stated only with regard to a deposit, he is obligated to take an oath even when denying his liability entirely, right? So Cohen said to Levi, I never took a loan of $1,000. I don't know what you're talking about. But if the claim is one that could be stated with regard to a loan, then the Bailey is obligated to take an oath only when he admits part of his liability. Anyway, the notion we try to go now, it's basically by Rashi, but it's important to know the Rabbeinu Tam.
If you have a shtar for the loan, that overrides anything, right? if there's a document that...
I wish not. That it's so simple.
No, okay.
I'll give you a case that just happened recently. It's a good point. Mm-hmm. It was the two brothers. One, let's say, live in England and one in the United States. And the father passed away, who live in the United States. And the brother, he basically took all the very expensive movable property from the father's estate. He claimed that when the father had a stroke several years ago, he wrote a note to him that he should take it. The other brother said that, number one, it was after the father was not well, but he said, you don't have a witnesses, you don't have a kinyan, ma'ase kinyan. So that promissory note, it's not, anyway.
No, I guess what I was asking was a shtar that you had edim. So there was a kinyan. If you had that, then that would sort of override it, right? If you had a shtar with edim and kinyan.
So the minute you have edim, that's a different story.
That's it, then. Yeah, okay, I understand. But the shtar itself is not.
Let me show with you the Quran edition of the translation of this Rambam. Sefer Mishpatim, Ilchot Zechirut, chapter 2, and also Ilchot Tohen V'Nit'an, chapter 1. You see also in Choshen Mishpat in 87. If Reuven claims that Shimon owes him money or movable property, and Shimon has a legal ability to absolve himself or any monetary obligation to Reuven by claiming that he has purchased or returned the money or property, or by completely denying having taken it in the first place, but in fact Shimon admits to part of the claim, he is obligated to pay the amount he admits to owing, and by the Torah law he takes an oath with regard to the rest of the claim and is exempt from paying the remainder. If a bailee or one who rented or borrowed an item denies a claim, he takes an oath by Torah law to exempt himself from payment, whether it be admitted to a part of the claim or deny it entirely. That's basically follow the ruling of Rabbi Chiya bar Yosef, that the verse is written with a merging of Torah portions. So anyway, v'chiktiv ki hu ze, amilveu dechtiv. So Rosh hold that applies to the etzem shvuat ha-shomrim, the essence of the oath of the guardians. Tosfot Reed hold that you need to have an oath. The question is, you need to have a partially admitting or daven miktzat or not. So what's the difference about the loan? So why only there? So he said, "Kide Rabbah, Amar Rabbah, Mipnei Amar Torah, Miktzat Hanah, Moveh Miktzat Hanah, Yishava, Chazaka, En Adam Meid Panav Bnei Baal Chovo." This is very important rules that we said that usually people are not behaving in such an ungrateful way. Meaning, Reuven gave Shimon $1,000, and he came back a month later and says, "Give me back the money." It's very unlikely, the presumption that a person does not exhibit insolence by lying in the presence of his creditor. It's kind of Rashi said in Gittin 51b. That's usual. The person did you a favor. I mean, people slap in the face, backstabbing, right? But in such a way, he lent you money, and now you say that he never did it. That's the general presumptions. The truth is, people like to do it, but so they said, says, if he admitted by entirely, so he sue me, take me for the entire. So therefore, ishtametli ma'ayashta, de'avule zuzu parana. So that's the reason why rabbinic law in that derivative imposed upon him. Like you see in general, that as we said, that people not do that. But let me share with you the way.
But by the same token, though, it's generally people that wouldn't claim that they loaned money to someone when they didn't either. Yeah. And take him to Beit Din to try to get
right,
him, you know.
Right, right. It's unlikely.
Yeah, unlikely but in both cases, but still. Yeah.
There is a Tosfot in Ketubot 18. Anyway, mm-hmm. wish to have more time. All right, so they said, where are we? V'gabei milveu de'ika le'meimar, ha'achei, aval gabei pikadon me'iz u'me'iz. Here the Gemara tried to differentiate between a loan and a deposit. Loan, we agree. But when he goes after the deposit, they say that me'izu me'iz, the Nemukei Yosef and others comment on this language. So Rashi said, Il kach afilu kafar bechulei, rame rachman ha'shvu alei. So if anyone who admits in part of it is obligated to take him out the regardless. Me'izu me'iz, because people does that. Tani Rami Bar Chama, Arba'a Shomrim. So, few things I want to mention here. First, the Tosfot, the very end of Masechet Shvuot, Tractate Shvuot, page 49a, ask a question when it's come to Arba'a Shomrim, why you have this Seder, this order? The way that it's written in the Torah, it's different. We have Shomer Chinam, Shomer Sachar, Socher Shoel. So Tosfot said that because from the extreme to the extreme in the middle. Rabbeinu Chananan also. The idea is that from Shomer Chinam, that Patur Me'akol, exempt, free belly from everything, to Shoel, that Chayav Be'akol, and those in between, Shomer Sachar Ve'Socher. So, Tani Rami Bar Chama. Arba'a Shomrim. There are four types of bellies. 107b. Tzrichin kfira b'mikzat v'hoda'a b'mikzat v'eluhen shomer chinam v'ashoel nusse sachar v'asocher. The Torah tells us in the book of Shmot, Exodus chapter 22, there are four types of custodians, of, or in British language, belly, and there are three categories. One, it's the unpaid custodian. Second one is a borrower, paid custodian, and a renter. So, Amar Rava, now bring the source for Rami Bar Chama. Ma itama de Rami Bar Chama, Shomer Chinam be yaktiv be kihuze. So the Shomer Chinam, the unpaid custodians, the Torah said clearly, kihuze. Kihuze, so this is it. So that's what we explained earlier. Shoel, v'chi ishal, vav mosif al yan rishon, the ed of the letter vav, vav achibu, show that it's connected to the previous one, which means borrower connected to shomer sachar. The same way that shomer sachar, the paid custodians, we not require him an oath for his claim, only if he admitted in part, סוחר, היא למד אמר כשומר שכר, היינו שומר שכר, ולמד אמר כשומר חינם, היינו שומר חינם. So it means that we need a הודעה במקצת, admit in part, the same as שומר חינם. Now about כפל, ואמר רבי חייא בר יוסף, הטוען טענת גנב בפיקדון, אינו חייב עד שישלח בו יד. It's not liable to pay double payment until he misappropriates it. Which means use it for his own needs before taking his oath. Ma'itam Adam akrav nikrav ba'al ba'it al Elokim im lo shalach yado b'melechet re'u. Michlal di shalach b'yad mechayev. So then, if he is misappropriates use it, so he's liable for double payment. Le'meimra de b'shalach yad askinan, that we are dealing only with the case that where he is misappropriated. So Tosfot Reed said, we have here a person who lied two times. Number one, he lied by saying that that deposit was stolen from him, while he's really used it for himself. Number two, that he said that he never touched it, lo shalach bo yad. In reality, he is. Now the Gemara bring another view, the one who disputed it. אמר להו, אמר להם, רבי חייא בר אבא, הכי אמר רבי יוחנן, בעומדת על אבוסה שנו. So here we're talking about the custodian still safeguarding it for its owner, because the animal is still standing over his feeding trough. So it means, he said, אמר לרבי זירא לרבי חייא בר אבא, דווקא באמת על אבוסה קמה. You have to say specifically in this case, אבל שלח ביד, if the custodian was used, meaning that he was distrust kana. So that's basically the same as gzeila, same as taking something belong to someone, that it's considered it's his and is responsible. That's the Gemara in Shvuot, page 43. Ushvuah lo me'anya beklum. So that the fact that they take an oath doesn't make any difference. So Rabbi Akiva Iger said that that's not a chidush, that's obvious. And that's the reason why he is not obligated to pay a double portion. If you have time, I'll read to you the Rambam here. But anyway, Odilma afilu medet al avusaka amar. So amar lei, zo lo shamati, ke yotze ba shamati. Amar Rabbi Yasi, amar Rabbi Yochanan, toen tanat avad ונשבא, וחזר ותנת הנגנב ונשבא, ובאו עדים פטור, מה הייתה, מה? למה משום דקנה בשבוע הראשונה? It's not because that, that he has already acquired the item with the first oath, and therefore the second oath is disregarded, which is why he's not liable for double payment for a false claim of theft. So the same way here, one is misappropriates the deposit, thereby acquires it, and is no longer obligated to take an oath. So amar lei, Rab Chiya said, Rab Zeira, Rab Chiya bar Abba, lo. It's not because he acquired that pikadon. Hoil v'yatza yedei be'alim b'shvu'a rishona. Since he left the owner's possession with the custodians, taking this first oath, so therefore he's exempt from taking an additional oath with regard to the same claim. But his oath would be significant even after having misappropriated the item. Itmar nami. So again, we wish we have more time. There is a very different view between Rashi and Tosfot here. Tosfot read and Torah Chaim bring it too. They say that's only if it's we enforce the oath. For example, if the owner came and sued him to the Beit Din, and then the second time the Beit Din imposed upon him an oath, Tosfot say that that's not enough to impose on him double payment, because he is not obligated to do it. But even he admitted that the first oath was not truth, because we have the Migo, we don't have he is trustworthy by the Migo, because how come you trust him by the second time and not by the first time, especially since he caught lying? Anyway, as we said, that is important notion here in the sugya. We're running out of time. So it mana me amar Rabbi Avin amar Rabbi Ila amar Rabbi Yochanan toen tanat avda bepikadon venishba וחזר וטען טענת גניבה ונשבע, ובא עדים פטור, הואיל ויצא ידי בעלים בשבועה ראשונה. That vignette of the Rambam. If a custodian claims that the deposit was lost and takes an oath to that effect, and subsequently claims that it was stolen and takes an oath to that effect, and then witnesses, the Edim, contradict his claim, he is exempt from paying double payment, as we said, usually incumbent upon the thieves, as the deposit is considered to have departed the owner's possession upon the custodian taking the first oath. That's also the 2 in Choshen Mishpan 352. The Chidushei Arim, the great Ger Rebbe, bring the famous Midrash of Avraham Avinu, Alav Shalom. They said that he gave the guest, those who appear like a malachim. So they said, Vekhapat Lechem, he gave them meat, he gave them bread, he gave cheese. So how come he's not giving, he didn't give them a fish? That's the Chidushei Arim. Why is not fish? It's good food. It tastes good. You know, they said about Shabbat fish, right? Ha'ochel dag b'yom dag, nitzol midag. One who eat fish on yom dag, is dalet plus gimel, it's seven. Nitzol midin ginom, so it's a good idea. It's a chashivut miyuchedet. So he bring the marshal. The marshal said that it was Rosh Hashanah, right? It's a famous midrash. That's the time the malachim came. So Rosh Hashanah, it's a time of a din, time of judgment, or you couldn't have the proper kavanot. Anyway, the Chidushei Arim said that the goal was to teach something. So when it's come to halachot, ilchot basar, the law of meat, it's many, many halachot. Same apply to gvina, to cheese. We have halachot, what to allow, what not allow, etc. When it's come to bread, we have the law of afrashat chala, we have the law of trumot umasrot, we have a lot of rules, but when it's come to dvarim shetzrichim limud, something that we need to have a derivative in halacha, that's the thing that the Abraham and the Torah refers to. Anyway, Amar Rav Sheshet, HaTohen Tanat Ganav Pikadon, Kevan Shalach Bo Yad Patur, Ma Ita Ma Achek Amar Rachmana Ben Kav, Bala Bait El Elohi, Im Lo Shalach Yado, Ha Shalach Yado Patur, Tosfot Seda, that's after Shavua. Omar Rav Nachman, Valo Shalosh Vod Mashbi'in Oto, that's the unpaid custodian, that he claimed that it was stolen from him, שבועה שלא פשעתי בה, שבועה שלא שלחתי בה. So because if he touched the deposit, he's already considered a robber. And he's responsible not only in honest, even in גניבה ועבידה, a stolen and lost item. שבועה שאינה ברשותי, so the Tosfot explains that he take an oath that that he's not holding it for himself with a false claim. מה אליו שבועה שלא שלחתי ביד ומדי שבועה שנה ברשותי, ומה שבועה שנה ברשותי, כי גל ימילתא דהיית ברשותי, חייב השבועה שלא שלחתי בה, כי גל ימילתא דשלח ביד, חייב. So the Rambam said that that's the essence of that an oath. אמר לי, לא, let me read the Rambam in a moment. שבועה שלא שלחתי ביד ומיד השבועה לא שפשעתי בה, ומה שבועה שלא פשעתי בה, כי מגל ימילתא דפשע בה פתור מכפל. אף שבועה שלא שלחתי ביד, כי מגל המילה שלח ביד, פטור מכפל. רמב״ם. רמב״ם, הלכות גניבת שפטר 4. He said, if a custodian claims that the deposit was stolen, but taken oath to that effect, only after misappropriating it, and after he takes the oath, it is contradicted by a witness testimony, he is not required to pay double payment. That's the Magid Mishnah said, follow the view of Rav Sheshet. The Ravid and the Rosh rule that he is required to pay double payment following Rav Zeira's inference from Rabbi Yochanan's opinion, and nothing that is also Rav Nachman's opinion as the Rav Sheshet challenged it. We said, this is the Shulchan Aruch Hoshel Mishpat 295, the three oaths administered. The oath of a custodian includes three elements: that the custodian safeguarded the item in a standard manner, that the circumstance that he claimed to have occurred did actually transpire, like a theft, loss, or death, such that the item is not presently in the custodian's possession, and that the custodian did not misappropriate the item prior to the loss. That's also the Rambam. And Sefer Mishpatim, Ilchot Sheela U'Pikadon, chapter C, 6. You see the Smite, the Taz, and the Choshen Mishpat. So what you see here, you have three Shalosh Shitot. You have three different avenues. One, Rav Chiya Bar Yosef, just try to wrap up. One, Rav Chiya Bar Yosef, what did he say? Is chayav kepfel. You have a double portion of payment. Only if shalach yad lifnei shenishba, before he taken oath. Then we have the shita of Rabbi Chiya Bar Abba from Rabbi Yochanan, Be'omedet al Evusa. And then we have the Davka Omedet al Evusa, or not. That's a discussion. Then we have the third one, is Shitat Rav Sheshet, said, Im Shalach Yad. So he's potur mikefel. Chayav bekefel if not shalach yad. So I have to conclude with the great Reb Meir of Premishlan. He said, Ulecha Hashem chased, ki ata teshalem le'ish kema'aseu. We hear dealing a lot with a person who pretend to do something. So he said, he saw someone who pretend to be a righteous man, and he wasn't. So he said, what does that mean, Ulecha Hashem chased? That God show his great kindness, great compassion. So he said, when he saw, Meir of Mishlan, saw someone who's not Tocho Kevaro, is not the way that he appears, he is real. So he said, that's the kindness of Hashem, that he's not punishing him the way he tried to present himself, but he punishes him the way that he knows that he is really, he is. And that's the idea when we talk today so much about people who pretend to be something and they are not, and later on, somehow, along the line, they find out differently.